बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम, वेलकम टू द न्यू सेशन। आर यू विद मी? ओके, ग्रेट। Typical size-oriented matrix, we have errors per kilo line of code, defects per kilo line of code, cost per line of code, pages of documentation per kilo line of code, errors per person month, errors per review hour, line of code per person month, cost per page of documentation. So that is the normal typical size oriented matrix we use in the software companies, in the software industry. This for the product matrix. Any question regarding the size oriented matrix? Any question? Typical function oriented matrix, if you have function, errors per function point, defects per function point, cost per function point, pages of documentation per function point per person month, that is the function oriented matrix if you are using functions. The previous slide was regarding the size in lines. Now we are talking about functions. In order to have quality, we have quality attributes as well in the product metric. The correctness, the degree to which program can be easily corrected, easily maintain the maintainability, how much it can protect itself from unauthorized access attack, how much easy to use. So these are few quality attributes. So for example, how easy to use, how it is easy to maintain, the quality of documentation, and so on. Now we have defect density metric. Defect density is the number of defects detected in a software product during the entire development life cycle. I already discussed the difference between errors and defects. Mr. Ahmed Adil, what is the difference between errors and defects? Raid Abdullah, Saad Ghalib, Mr. Sultan, even I call the next name, you can answer, no problem. Ghazi Muhammad, Muhammad Mabrek, Muhammad Marai, very good. Muhammad Yasin, Garamullah, okay, open, anyone can answer the difference between errors and defects. Errors are the bugs reported by the software development team. Whereas defects are the bugs reported by the customer this is the difference between errors and defects is it clear to everyone so now we are talking about defects defect density number of defects detected reported during the entire development life cycle divided by size in LOC or function point you can calculate the defect density this is the formula to calculate for example number of defects are 40 and size is 1000 so 40 divided by 1000 multiplied by 100 so you have 4 is the in percentage defect density per size per lines or per function point that is the defect density formula now I move to functionality metric number of functions correctly implemented divided by total number of functions in the functional specs I gave you exercise assignment in which you have done the functional specs the number of functions you have implemented divided by total number of functions so that is the functionality metric to calculate functionality metric we have this formula repairability metric reliability metric mean time to repair and mean time to failure so reliability is equal to mean time between failure is equal to mean time to failure plus mean time to repair that is the reliability metric formula so mean time between failure is equal to mean time to failure plus mean time to repair that is the reliability availability mean time to failure divided by mean time to failure plus mean time to repair multiplied by 100 that is the availability metric how much the software will be available to the users and performing its functionality without failure that is the availability metric usability how it is easy to use how it is easy to understood learned and used we have dimensions of usability anybody knows the dimension of usability Ali Shakir Atawla Ahmed Adil Abdullah Khalid Muhammad Ahmed anyone open anybody knows the dimensions of usability okay we have understandability learnability operability attractiveness usability compliance these are the five dimensions of usability so how easy to understand how easy to learn how easy to operate how much it catch attractiveness by the user, and how much it is developed in terms of standards, that is the usability compliance, in terms of interfaces, in terms of icons, standard, that is the usability compliance. Easy to understand, easy to learn, easy to operate, attractive to the user, and developed as per the conventions, styles, and standards related to the usability, that is the usability compliance. So usability metric is equal to number of functions understood divided by total number of functions. This is the formula to calculate the usability metric. Any question up to here? By any student, any question from any student? Dimensions of usability and the metric. Liability metric, availability metric, functionality metric. Then you have portability metric. How much it is easy to portable to run on multiple platforms. So degree of portability is equal to 1 minus cost to portability divided by cost to redevelop. That is the formula to calculate. So we call it DP, degree of portability. 1 minus cost to portability divided by cost to redevelop. Now regarding the quality, I have a story of Samsung company. The Samsung company, it was flourished, it was groomed by Lee Kun-hee, and he was very poor student, and his father always believed that he will demolish, he will destroy the company, and he was not a good student. His father was never satisfied. So he was sent to USA for advanced studies, but he did his bachelor, but could not complete his master. And then his father called him and asked him to run the company with him, to help him in the construction business, in the trading business. So that was the background of Samsung. And he believed that his son will sink the company like Titanic. And company was running 34 different fields at that time in 1987. His father died. So from 1987 to 1993, Lee Kun-hee was suffering, running from one company to another company. Then he realized that Samsung company is working in too many areas. They should have focus on quality. So the quality, other competitors have only one product, but the Samsung has 34 different fields. They are not focusing on quality. So they should improve the quality of their products to have name of Samsung and to have successful business. And then he called his chief executives, the stakeholders, managers, and he told them, we will change our company policy. Instead of quantity, we will focus on quality. Forget about the loss. We will suffer, no problem. But Samsung name should be quality name as a guarantee. And customer must be satisfied. So this was a shift in 1993. And his managers, stakeholders ask him, it's very risky, and we will suffer a loss. He said, no problem. I'm asking you to change the company policy from quantity to quality. And then next few years were very difficult, but then they start developing the electronics, the TV. And this was the time when Samsung company groomed and became successful company in terms of production, quality, sale. So in 1998, they started Galaxy phone, smartphone. And that time Nokia was suffering. And within few years, the company became $350 billion company. Now, even after his death, in 2020, the company revenue is $200 billion. And he was more richer than the Korea. It's a Korean company. The two main reasons, first pillar of success was R&D, research and development, very strong. They hired qualified people, qualified software, hardware engineers, and they were the leaders from last more than 10 years, 15 years. And secondly, they never compromised on quality. You can pick any product of Samsung from packing to the size, you will be amazed by the quality. And that's the reason Samsung company is so successful. That is the because of the quality product. Second company is IKEA. Some people call it IKEA. IKEA is also name of successful quality products in furniture. In 1943, it was established, and now all over the world, they have a business, even in Saudi Arabia, in Germany, in America. Germany has 53 stores, in America 51 stores. All over the world you can find IKEA, and you can see any product from IKEA, you will immediately note down that this product is from IKEA. That is totally different from the other vendors, other competitors. Company revenue in 2019 was 41.3 billion euro. From a small company to a large company, multinational company, and it is a huge success by IKEA in the furniture market. So that is the two examples of quality products. And software examples, Mac was the first operating system introduced by Apple company, Macintosh, in 1984. Windows was introduced in 1990. Linux was introduced after that. But if you compare the operating system market, Windows market is almost 90% of the entire market. Apple market, Mac is 2-3% of the entire market. Linux is also few percent. So Windows is the most widely practiced client operating system in the world. Windows is the most widely used OS in the world, client OS in the world. And Linux is the most widely used server operating system in the world. each has unique property, unique quality attribute all of the success. Windows secret of success is, Mr. Raid, what is the secret of Windows success? Sultan, Shakir, Abdul Latif, usability, very good. Windows secret of success is usability. As a client operating system, what is the secret of Linux success? Ghazi, Abdullah, security, very good. Strong security. Different quality attribute, but this quality attribute becomes the success of quality product. SAP is the most widely used ERP system in the world. We have Oracle. We have Microsoft Dynamics. Oracle, Microsoft Dynamics are there. Oracle, Microsoft Dynamics. Among three, SAP is the most widely used ERP system in the world. Why? Abdullah, Ali, Sultan, Muhammad Mabrek, Majid, Ahmed Adil, Raid Abdullah, Sultan, Shakir, anyone, open. Among the three, anyone else other than Muhammad Yasin, he is saying it's a sustainable system. Other than this one, reliable, more secure, more functional. So reliability, security, functionality are the key quality attributes. Because of that, SAP is the most widely practiced ERP system in the world. So we discussed three examples in the operating system, three examples in the application software, and each is successful in the market because of their unique characteristics, unique quality attributes. This is the end of quality of the products, the quality metric for the products. Now we move to the process metric. In the process, the methodologies, we have to select the methodology at the beginning of project. There could be any criteria. Because of that, we can select the methodology, like the nature of the project, or sometimes customer impose you to use specific methodology like Scrum. Like now, Agile is very popular, and investors only invest in the Agile projects, especially come. If you are using Scrum, then investors are ready to invest because of high ROI. What is ROI, Ali Ali? Abdul Latif Garmullah, Abdullah Khalid, return on investment. Because of high return on investment, investors are only ready to invest in agile Scrum projects. So that could be sometime investors force you to use specific methodology or the company policy, what the methodology they are using. So once you select the methodology, then you start the SDLC activities, planning, analysis, design. What we need to measure in the process: number of errors uncovered before release of software or defects reported by the customer, work product delivery productivity, human effort, time, schedule conformance, how much we are meeting the time deadlines, so you have common sense approach to use process metrics, provide regular feedback loop between the team and the users or the stakeholders. Don't use metric to appraise individuals, the team members. Work with the team to select clear goals and metrics that will be used to achieve, that are achievable. Never use metric to threaten individuals. And that indicate a problem area, and it should not consider negative. You have to learn to improve that, and don't depend on single metric. You have other metrics, project metric, you have product metric. The process metric related to quality, focus on quality of the work product, production in terms of effort, and statistical SQA data activities, error categorization and analysis, defect removal efficiency, reuse data. These all are process metrics. In terms of cost, how much the methodology you are applying is cutting down the cost saving, time saving, effort saving, errors reduction, defects reduction, how much performance is improving of the team members or the processes. So that are process metrics. Now you have a defect removal efficiency formula in the process metric. Errors divided by errors plus defects multiplied by 100. That is the defect removal efficiency formula. Let's have an exercise. So defect removal efficiency is equal to, there are 60 errors and 40 defects. 60 divided by 100 is equal to 60 divided by 60 plus 40 multiply by 100. Bismillah. Calculate, everyone. Very good. 60% is the defect removal efficiency of this company from where I took the sample. Everybody has done. Now, release two. This is the release one. In the release two, you have 26 errors, 16 defects. 26 divided by 26 plus 16 multiplied by 100. Bismillah, 62%. So from release 1 to release 2, 62%. 62%. This for release 2. So from release 1 to release 2, defect removal efficiency is improved from 60 to 62%. So that is the way to calculate the defect removal efficiency. Any question up to here? Any question up to here? Very good. Now you have test effectiveness ratio. That is also under the process metric. Test effectiveness ratio is equal to M over N. Test cases cover M objects. N test strategy requires to cover N objects like statements, paths, functions. So we have TER1, test effectiveness ratio 1, formula number of statements executed by the test data divided by total number of executable statements. Or number of control flow branches executed by the test data divided by total number of control flow branches. From the flow chart, you can see the control flow branches. Total and number of branches executed during the test cases, during the test data. Test efficiency, number of defects detected divided by number of test cases executed. That is your test efficiency. For example, you have detected 40 defects and you have executed test cases 10. Forty divided by ten multiplied by hundred. So your test efficiency is 400%. If you have done like 40 divided by 100, then multiply by 100. This is the way you can calculate, make it like 100. That's much better to understand. That is 40% is your test efficiency. Now I move to the project metric. Start on the right foot. Understand the problem. Realistic objectives, expectations. Form a good team. maintain momentum. So you have quality on every task in terms of team, high output, and your team will be retained and make sure the top management or stakeholders stay away from the team. Track progress, track the completion, that how much Sirat-e-Mustaqim and how much Shaitan path. So Sirat-e-Mustaqim Alatul Sida and Shaitan path is zigzag. How far you are from the actual. Keep on estimating the velocity of the project. Measure velocity of the project. After each release, to find the difference between planned budget and actual budget. Planned schedule and actual schedule. To take corrective actions. Otherwise, there is a failure, jhannam, waiting for the company. That is the common sense approach for the project. Any question up to here? Any question up to here? Make smart decisions. Keep it simple. Use COTS. What is COTS? Muhammad Mabrek, Muhammad Marai, Majid, Sultan, Raed, open anyone, Cots. Commercial off the shelf, very good. Commercial off the shelf components. Ready-made components, very good, very good. Ready-made components. Off the shelf components mean ready-made components from third party. Instead of developing from scratch, that means line one. If you don't have, it's best to purchase third party components from the vendor. Like I gave you example of Descon, Infosys. Descon Infosys had a project in USA and they're still working on that. It was ERP system for a property estate business. Property estate business, www.realestate.com. Realestate.com. And the software company was using C Sharp as a front end, C sharp as business logic, and Microsoft SQL Server, Microsoft SQL Server, SQL Server, the backend. After a couple of years, customer asked the company to switch the business logic from C sharp to Java Versata. Java Versata. Java Versata is a business logic suite, and it is very secure, and it is auto code generator. You write the statement, it will convert the code into Java by itself. And software company Descon doesn't have single Java developer. And then project manager name is Khaver. He is now US in USA because customer later on demand the company to be in US within the premises of the customer side. He called me because that time I was doing my PhD. I was in contact with software companies. He called me early morning that, Mr. Rizwan, you know any company who is using Java Versata? I say, what? Because I first time heard. I'm talking about 2007-2008. Then he said, okay, can you check for me any software company in locality, in my location, who is using Java Versata? I called 40 to 50 software companies where my students were working. None of the student or the company they found. Ultimately, they purchased cards from American client, American software company. They become client of that company. So they have customer and they become customer for another company, the cards. SAP is another example of cards. Instead of you develop ERP from scratch line one, it's better you purchase SAP from SA company, ERP from SAP company. So COTS or existing software before writing new code. Don't go for writing new code, line one, scratch one, because what is the benefit of using cards or reusable components? Instead of benefit of cards or reusable components, as compared to writing develop a new component from the scratch, Who will answer? For C, Majid. Muhammad Babrek. Muhammad Marai. Shakir. Sultan. Fast time to market. Okay, open. Anyone can answer. Anyone can answer? First of all, cost saving, time saving. If you reuse previous component or you purchase cards versus you write the code from the scratch line one, approximately 51% time and cost are saved. As per a research, that is the reason software companies prefer to customize their products instead of going for new products, new projects. Software companies don't deal in projects anymore. They deal in products. Reuse previous code because there is time saving, cost saving. Secondly, in terms of reliability, reliability of reusable components or cards are very high as compared to new code. There was a scientist who compared these metrics and he developed one application with reusable components and one application from the scratch line one. And he has concluded that the reusable components 0.9 defects per kilo line of code are reusable components reported. And for the new application, which is developed from the scratch, line one, 4.1 defects per KLOC are reported. So there is a huge difference between 0.9 defects, which is less than one over 1,000 lines. Here you have 4.1 defects per 1,000 lines. So that is the huge impact if you have 30,000, 40,000, 100,000 lines. So reusable components, cards, they are more reliable as compared to develop a component from scratch line one. For time saving, cost saving, reliability, because of that, use cards or previously developed components. And there is a risk of failure. If new components fail, company has to bear a loss. So that is the reason it's not recommended. And architect always forced the programmers to customize, to reuse the previous components instead of developing the new components. The risky is there. That is regarding the making smart decisions. Conduct review sessions continuously, post-mortem analysis, FTR, walkthrough, sprint review, sprint retrospective, and we have collaborate. Deliver. Reflect and improve. Cycle in Agile. It is called CDRI. Cycle. Collaborate, deliver, reflect, improve. So collaboration of the team in terms of coordination, communication should be improved release by release, sprint by sprint, and quality of delivery should be improved release by release. That is the collaborate, deliver. So you have two sub-cycle, collaborate and improve, deliver and improve. So collaboration should be improved and quality of delivery should be improved release by release. And this improvement should be reflected in terms of time, cost, effort, errors. And there is PDCA. P for plan, do, check, and act cycle. That I will cover inshallah in the next chapter. That is also very important for the review sessions. Any question regarding postmortem, we already covered. FTR, we already covered. Walkthrough, we covered. Sprint review, sprint retrospective. What is postmortem? If you will not ask, then I will ask. Postmortem analysis. Dar Ghalib. Raid. Majid. Muhammad Mabrek. Abdul Latif. Shakir. Anyone, open. Postmortem analysis. Postmortem is taken from medical, like somebody is killed, police, Marur, Shurta, they will take the dead body to hospital and doctors will cut the body to find the cause of death, time of death, like killed by bullet, by knife, by some, or somebody stopped his breathing by putting cushion or pillow on his face or hang him to find the cause of death. Similarly, after each release, you will perform postmortem analysis to learn from your mistakes, that what are the mistakes we have done during the previous release. Learn from your mistakes and you will not repeat those mistakes in the upcoming release. So learn from your mistakes that you have performed during the development of previous release. So before starting the next release, you perform postmortem analysis, like improvement in your processes, activities, resources, any extra resources, any extra process, any extra activities you have to remove to optimize. That is the postmortem analysis. Any question regarding the postmortem analysis from any student? FTR stands for Sultan Ahmed Adil Abdullah Muhammad Mabrek Ghazi Yasin Haroon. Anyone, open. You want to use mic? You can use mic. but one by one. If you want to type, you are free. FTR stands for Formal Technical Review. Yes, Formal Technical Review. FTR is a session that you conducted after each phase, during planning, during analysis, during design, during coding, during testing, during maintenance. So planning document, analysis document, design document, project specs, function specs, design specs, code, test, maintenance documents. So FTR is a planned meeting, planned session. You inform the agenda before the meeting and you ask the team members to come up with their recommendations, reservations, improvements before you attend the session. 3 to 5 members attend the session and project manager will discuss the agenda and then ask the team members to discuss their reservations, improvements, recommendation. The team member may accept the agenda, may reject or may recommend improvements. And there is a secretary who is taking minutes of meeting, record the session. 1 to 2 hours, you will finish the meeting, and in the next session, the secretary will discuss that these are the reservations, improvements in the previous session, these are implemented or not. If they are not implemented, you will not start the next session. If they are implemented, then you start the next session. So sprint, a formal technical review is used to find any missing function, logic, or implementation, and you are developing the project according to the software company standards, mission statement, goals, writing the code as per the template of the company, and this is one of the techniques that you can estimate the velocity of the project, that you are going in the right direction to make project more manageable. That is the objective of FTR. So postmortem analysis is used after the release, FTR during the release, during planning, during analysis, during design, during coding, during testing, during maintenance. Any question? Any question? Okay. Walkthrough is informal. The project manager or the team lead will pass by the programmer, pass by the tester, pass by the team member, designer, architect, database designer, that what you are doing, explain the code, explain the function. It's informal, and to make sure that the functions what are approved during the function specs, they are implementing or not, the programmer understood the requirements or not. So that is the walkthrough. Walkthrough is informal. Postmortem and FTR are the formal techniques. They are used in the traditional methodologies. Whereas sprint review is for agile. And it is like postmortem, not postmortem, it is like FTR, that you perform sprint review before the release. And sprint retrospective is like the postmortem after the release. So sprint review, you have like FTR, you will call the project manager or the product owner to make sure any function, any story is missing or not, is properly implemented or not, as per customer requirements or not. So that's the objective of sprint review. and sprint retrospective is like the postmortem analysis after the release to learn from your mistakes at the end of one sprint before beginning the new sprint. And collaborate, deliver, reflect, improve, that is throughout the development, that after each release you check how much your collaboration, after each meeting, how much your collaboration is improved, after each release, how much quality of delivery is improved. So project manager or the stakeholder investors, they are just reported about the improvement in the quality of delivery and improvement in the collaboration after each meeting. Like in Scrum, you have daily meeting which is called stand-up meetings. Stand-up meetings. It is like the daily meetings, but you really stand up, not sit. And in the stand-up meeting, you will check that you have implemented the requirements, or what are the requirements not implemented yesterday, what are the tasks of today, and why not implemented, what is the reason. This is all. And you check the testing, you perform daily testing, the testing results of the last day, integration testing results. So that is the stand-up meetings. So during the collaboration and improvement cycle, the results of the stand-up meetings, how much your meeting time is reducing, how much your quality of delivery is improving. So this is the review sessions. Any question up to here? Any question regarding accept, plan, do, check, act cycle? Any question about the review sessions? So objective is to track lesson learned for each project, each release, compare plan and actual schedule, collect and analyze software project metrics, get feedback from the team members and the customers, record findings in written form. That is the objective of review sessions. The sign project is in danger. Team does not understand the customer needs. Scope is poorly defined. Changes are managed poorly. Chosen technology changes. Business need change or poorly defined. Jeopardy means danger. Project is going to fail. Users are resistant, reluctant. Maybe they are scared that if project is implemented, we may lose job. Sponsorship is lost. Investors stop funding or thinking to stop. Team lacks people with appropriate skills. Manager or the project manager or the product owner or the product specialist avoid best practices and lessons learned. Like I will show you one example. I specially downloaded a paper for you. It is published in 2008. The title is Bootstrapping Scrum and XP Under Crisis, a story from the trenches. If you read the abstract, a Swedish company underwent a fast and dramatic agile transitioning process driven by a crisis situation. Many of the lessons learned are described, blah, blah, blah. The critical decisions and changes made during the first few months that ultimately transformed a burning and sinking ship into a fairly well-oiled agile software development. So Ten is a gaming software company, Sweden based in Stockholm, and they have a gaming competition, poker game, and the annual prize, gaming competition prize, is €320,000. That is the prize money for that gaming competition. And company was suffering because the stakeholders were playing with the team members. As you can see, marketing, support, operational, chief information officer, customer, all are directly interacting with the team. So for example, Mohammed Marai is working on some code. Suddenly one stakeholder came, asked him, stop this. Ahmed Adil is working on another, for example, server platform. Stop this. Ghazi is working on back office. Stop this. Database, stop this. Do this first. So the team was frustrated. They don't know what to do. And software was not stable. Releases were not stable. There were a lot of bugs. And there was a stress, panic. And company was thinking to fire many team members. There was a job threat, job risk, pressure. It was totally push environment. And then company hired product owner. And then he asked the stakeholders to stay away from the team and provide requirement stories only to the product owner, and product owner will provide those stories to the team. So there will be only one interface, one window for all stakeholders. That is the product owner. No interaction with the team. Stop interaction with the team. Stay away from the programmers, from the team members. And let me show you then how team looks. Yes. As you can see, now this only product owner, stakeholders will provide stories to the product owner, and he will provide the team stories to the team. So they have product backlog, then sprint backlog, and then sprint review and sprint retrospective. So self-learning, self-organized, cross-functional team, stable releases. So morale became high because of the success releases, successful releases. So burning team was changed into agile team, failure team into successful team. So let me show you. So they have completed their goals, succeed with the poker competition, system stable, scalable, effective human work environment, all were achieved after this failure team to a successful team. So that is the paper that shows how a failure team is transformed to successful team, how to have successful software development and stop involving the involvement of interaction of the stakeholders with the team. So this is how you can avoid these signs. I think it's enough for this session. Any question about this session? Any topic we covered? Any question from any student? Any question? Okay. Thank you very much, inshallah. After the Jummah pray, we'll continue at 1:30, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.